afternoon. Thank you for being here. My name is Jesse Mills. I'm in the Ethnic Studies Department and also work here with Collaborative Research in the Humanities Center. Thank you for taking the time to come out and hear our fabulous panel about how I became interested in humanities research with our Keck Humanities Fellows. Can we just start with a little welcome and gratitude for our panelists? So momentarily, they're going to get going. They're going to introduce themselves and what their project is. But really what we had conceptualized with this was a sort of more informal session with them speaking more on the experience of sort of why they applied in the first place for a Keck Fellowship, what their experience has been, and sort of this is a bit of a, I guess, a preview of the projects they'll be presenting early in May, early next month. So why don't we go ahead and if you could just sort of introduce yourselves, we'll start on the end with Emma, and just sort of your name and year and what your project is.
Well, my name is Emma Dixon. I'm a senior, and my project is about how theater can be used to help convey scientific concepts to a general audience.
And your mentor is?
My mentor is Monica Steff from the theater department.
Hi everyone, my name is Sophie Aber. I'm a senior double major in behavioral neuroscience and anthropology with a chem minor. My project is titled Women, Agency, and Resistance from the Salem Witch Trials to the Me Too Movement. And my mentor is Dr. Kate DeConnick from the theology department.
Hello, I'm Amber Sheldon. My project title is Wittgenstein and Embodied Cognition, a Critique of the Language of Thought. And in my research, I went through the private language argument as given by Wittgenstein in the Philosophical Investigations. And then I sort of broadened it into philosophy of mind and how it could, well, first, after arguing against Fodor's language of thought, how we could maybe implement a different sort of idea of language into also our understanding of the mind using embodied cognition. Oh, and I'm a philosophy major with a French minor, and my research mentor was Dr. Brian Clapp.
Hi, all. I'm Kayla. This is my last year of graduating. I'm a philosophy major and a woman in gender studies minor. I don't have a clever name for my title yet, but so far it's the appropriation of the woman from Greek mythology to philosophy. I'm tracking Greek myths and how they became intellectualized in the early philosophy, and then how it kind of set the tone and discourse on the language of woman from there on out. My mentor was, or is, Professor Greer from the philosophy department.
My name is Becca, I'm a senior, and I'm looking at how Catholicism influenced and then also reacted to the development of the death penalty in the United States, and also kind of going further on to how a lot of Christian-based terror groups used the death penalty to sort of take over lynching when lynching became sort of more policed in the United States. So really three topics. And my mentor is Kate DeConnick in the theology department as well.
I'm Jordan. I'm a second year student here. I'm a computer science and math major. The title of my project is Python Regular Expressions and Corpus Preparation, a New Way to Solve an Old Problem, and it's concerned with authorship attribution of some 16th century texts. And my mentor is Paul Woods.
Hi, my name is Misha Shabazz. I'm a junior here, and my research is titled A Legal and Ethical Examination of Photorealistic Videos Created Using Artificial Neural Networks. So what I was trying to do with my research is bridge the gap between humanities and technology and just offer a humanist perspective on the growth and development of technology in our society. And my mentor is Dr. Achary Fukan, and my major is interdisciplinary humanities. And I apologize, I will be having to step out a little early because I have class, but I couldn't miss this event, so thank you for coming.
Thank you, everybody. Wow, these are absolutely fascinating interests and topics that you're pursuing. So the first question I'd like to throw out is, how did you come up with your project idea? And you can maybe tie on to that, sort of how did you know that a Keck Humanities Fellowship was the right direction for you to go to pursue that? If anyone wants to jump in, that's fine. Please, go ahead.
So my project actually kind of began as an independent study in spring of 2018, so last year. And I guess I kind of had the idea to begin with because I've worked on a lot of research for a really long time. I've worked for Pfizer since I was a freshman doing biochemical research. I did bee research in a behavior lab at UCSD, and I also have worked concurrently with this project on a project about perceptions with eating disorders with Dr. Rebecca Wanick in the psych department. But I found that I hadn't really explored humanities research very much, and that was something that I really wanted to do. So Dr. DeConnick and I started looking at witch panics in the early modern period, mostly from more of a historical perspective. And then I decided that the Keck Fellowship was something that I was really interested in when I decided that I kind of wanted to look at those things from a more anthropological perspective, which had not been done before. Whereas, you know, there are definitely people that have done historical research on witch panics, but taking that anthropological perspective towards my research was what really made me want to apply for Keck.
I've always been really interested in the intersection of science and theater. I'm a theater major. I thought when I started college that I was gonna be a physics major, but I found out I absolutely hate doing lab. But I've always been really passionate about how the two coincide. But there's actually, so I always knew that I wanted to do that for my honors senior thesis. And then I like read about the CAG and realized there'd be a chance to do like a more practical version of this, because the honors work that I'm doing is all very theoretical, but with the support of the Keck, I get to do like practical stuff. Like I got to work as a researcher on an actual production of one of those, Arcadia, one of those famous plays that deal with science. And then I also am going to be hosting like an event for scientists and theater artists to make connections. And I couldn't have done that just with the research opportunities that an honors thesis.
Mine sort of fell into my lap when I took a class my junior year about Catholicism in the U.S. and how a lot of Catholicism impacted, especially colonial law, but just how that kind of continues into the history of our Catholicism. And then my interest in law sort of, it just sort of developed into this idea that it's possible that because Jesus died on the cross for his sins against the state, maybe that was something that the founding fathers used in their original ideas when they were developing the like punishment in the United States. And so we started looking at that, and it was just something that sort of developed over time. It wasn't something that I was ever interested in before this year. So it was more of an organic like, process. And then I wanted to present it was, as opposed to going to a bunch of places to speak about it or write papers on it, I wanted to do a more interactive thing. So I wanted to do an exhibit because I thought it would really help people like humanize the topic as opposed to just having a lot of facts and figures. And so I reached out to people and started looking into the Keck Fellowship because I knew that they had that flexibility in presentations and they had the financial and just the social support in the Humanities Center for me to do something like that. And it's next Wednesday if you guys want to come.
I would say for me it started, I'm a philosophy major, so I took many philosophy classes. And I noticed always at the end of the classes there was like a little tidbit on feminist philosophy. And it always struck me as odd why it needed to be segregated from just philosophy, you know? So that kind of piqued my interest. And originally I had a totally different train of thought for the research that I was going to do, and it kind of morphed as I started to get into it. But it's funny, for the Keck Fellowship, I had heard of it from people who had done it prior and their experience, and so I thought it would just be an amazing opportunity to kind of try to start. But I wasn't sure, I knew I was doing philosophy and I knew that was humanities, but I wasn't sure like how it could be interdisciplinary. And that was something I was interested in. So I did realize that, talking to my mentor though, just the fact that it was philosophy and then gender studies, and then if you're writing at the time, I was going to write a satire that was like in English. And it just like organically became this kind of like disciplinary work. So that's how I knew like the Keck was right for me.
Yeah, so when I got here, I knew I was a computer science major, but admittedly I hated computer science classes. I just didn't like that a lot of the projects that I was given, the assignments I had, served like no purpose except demonstrating what I had learned. Luckily my advisor knew Maura Giles Watson in the English department, and she had been working on the computer space project for some time now, and that's how I got involved. And then the opportunity to get involved with the Keck Fellowship came up at the end of my first year, and ultimately I think that it was the right decision because the financial support, but also the credit, really helps carve out time particular project, so that things sometimes get muddled and dampened by, you know, your other school obligations. But so, I mean, that's what worked for me.
So I knew that I wanted to do research during my undergraduate years, and so I went into the Office of Undergraduate Research and I talked with them, and this was back in March. And I was looking actually for summer opportunities to do research, but they said the application had already passed, but they said you could do a Keck fellowship. And it was specifically interdisciplinary. And like I said, my major is interdisciplinary humanities, and so I thought this would be a perfect fit. I had no idea what I wanted to research. That part was very stressful for me because I didn't know what I could say, how I could contribute, what was something new that I could bring to the table. And then I came across these fake photorealistic videos, and from there, I went to Dr. Fukan asking her if she would help me with this research. And so if you guys are looking for a mentor, I think that's one question people often get is, you just have to approach and ask. My mom always says, if you don't ask, the answer is always no. So you should just go up to teachers, ask them, tell them what you're interested in, and they will really help you from there. I think that's a great part of USD is that the teachers are so engaging, and because of the smaller classes, they are able to really work with students instead of just being overwhelmed in that regard. So everyone else seems like they had a pretty clear mindset of what they wanted to study. I did not, and that's just the beauty of the Keck Fellowship is you have people coming from all different areas, from all different backgrounds, all different experiences. So, yeah.
Hi.
Oh,
am I next?
Oh, okay, good. I've always been really interested in philosophy of mind. It's actually what drew me the most to philosophy. So for my honors thesis, I wrote a really obscure paper on epiphenomenalism and panpsychism, which was an interesting experience, but it wasn't really what I wanted to do, but I kind of figured out I want to try to come up with a way that I would like to conceive of the mind that is not within the typical frameworks of functionalism or pure reductivism or computational theories. And I was also taking, this was a year ago, a phonetics class for my French minor. And I thought that the way that languages were built and spoken and how they change through speech and action and how they're used was a very interesting concept that I hadn't really taken in before, especially thinking of theories of mind where sentences are built in your brain and we came up with language to convey them. Whereas when you're learning phonetics or even when you're learning a second language, it doesn't feel like that's how it comes together. And so I was familiar with Wittgenstein's philosophical investigations, but I never really had time to read it in depth, and it's rather difficult. So this experience definitely gave me the time to do so. And then over time, I realized I could really incorporate this interest in language and externality and interactive forms of learning with my interest in consciousness in the mind and how those things actually interplay with each other, rather than the mind just being a brain robot stuck in a meat puppet. So that was kind of how I came to my idea, but this sort of came, I knew I wanted to do the philosophical investigations and the language of thought and philosophy of mind or something when I came into the project, and then it sort of took its direction once it started.
Getting 8 busy Keck fellows here to present was quite a feat, and as you see, they're kind of coming and going from their busy life. But we were joined by our final Keck fellow, so if you could just introduce your name and major and your project title, and they're just going around answering sort of how you came to them. How did you come up with your project title?
Gotcha. So my name is Fazelle Lathan. I'm a senior here. My major is theater and performance studies. And the title of my research project is Integrating Traditional West African Practices into Main Stage Theater through the Concept of a Musical. So right now I am outlining and designing a musical. Hopefully that I can sail to the Old Globe, because I'm interning right now, so hopefully produce in like maybe a decade or so. And the way I came up through mine was actually stumbled upon the Keck Fellowship program. I was looking research was one of those ways, and I thought, you know, like theater people, we research all the time. It's most of our job. We just don't call it research. And so I called the undergraduate research department office, and then they told me about the Keck Fellowship, and then I emailed Professor Mills, and then he was like, yeah, you should apply. I applied, and lo and behold, for some odd reason, they accepted it. And the way I came up with the idea, I was studying in Rome at the time, and I went to go see, I went to London to see The Lion King on the musical. And at the end of it, you know, of course, it's a standing ovation in the Lyceum Theater. And I'm looking around, I'm like, wow, there is a majority white audience applauding like African culture, but there's an absence of black bodies. And I thought, would that same reaction happen if this was instead not fictional animals, but instead like actual human beings whose color was black? And that was one thought. And then I went to Paris on a trip, and I stopped into an African museum, and they showed me all these artifacts. And I was like, wow, all of these are so like theatrical. Like, I had no idea. And I thought, okay, oh, I should make a musical. Because Black Panther also came out, so I thought like, Black Panther and Lion King crossover is kind of the idea I had in my head. And now I'm like, actually doing it.
Hopefully it's no mystery to anyone why they were all awarded these fellowships. Amazing ideas. I'd like to just maybe tee up one last question for you all to have a chance to go around on before we maybe invite some interaction and questions. And what it is some of you spoke to your ideas evolving. So can you just maybe, you can speak generally or give us a little story about how did your research evolve throughout so far, because you're about three quarters of the way through. So how have you experienced the research process? Like, has anything unexpected come up? How have you adjusted to that? And let's just take that.
I will say that my research has evolved in ways that, like, going into it, I never foresaw. Going in, I was planning on writing like a satire about the explicit statements of philosophers over time on women, and trying to show just how like outlandish and funny they were. And the whole point was to maybe our gender standards would be the same in 200 years. But I started with Plato because everyone says he's the father of philosophy, and I got stuck on Plato. I couldn't figure him out. Everything he says contradicts the other thing about women, and everyone who comments on him kind of pulls some things but ignores the rest, and I just couldn't get over Plato, and I couldn't move on from him. So I actually started going backwards in my investigations and started looking into what encouraged his thought, and that's why I got into Greek mythology. And so for my project, I'll say with the Keck that typically in like an academic setting, you're given a task to complete within a certain amount of time, within a certain framework. And if that was the case, like, I surely could have produced the satire and it probably would have been fine, but having the space and the time to be able to follow your own like path in the research and to let like different things take you different places, and that was incredible. I've never had that in my like academic career before. So it was a really fruitful experience. And in a sense, it was challenging because you don't typically like have the ability to just, you know, change course. but it was really the support of everyone in the Keck itself, like, it allowed me to be able to just change my project and to look into different things. So I will say my project definitely evolved, but I think it's because of like the space that the Keck Fellowship allows you. We have a whole year to do it. So there was no time pressure or anything. If you wanted just to read another book, you could, you know what I mean? You didn't have that due date.
Having done independent research before, I've had my ideas shift and change, my entire thesis morph throughout the process. So that wasn't really something that surprised me when it happened, but I am surprised in the way that it went. Because before talking with Dr. Clack about Gilbert Ryle and this book he wrote called Concept of Mind and how it differs from what Wittgenstein is saying in the philosophical investigations, because I was having trouble not making Wittgenstein a behaviorist because I did not want to go down that road. And then after reading this
what would you call it, quintessential behaviorist literature. It was easy to draw those distinctions and really draw what was similar about Wittgenstein with contemporary embodied cognition and how I wanted to blend those two ideas together. And I didn't even think it was going to go in this direction. I wasn't even really familiar with embodied cognition. I had been to a conference where people presented their empirical scientific data on embodied cognitive studies with children and things like that, but I did not know that it was a philosophical field until I'd spoken with a different professor. So that was how mine changed, and it really changed for the better. It was rather exciting, and I learned something way newer than I ever would have thought I was going to. And then another change occurred. This one surprised me, and it was a major obstacle that turned out pretty well. So I was going to submit this paper for a writing sample for graduate school last fall, and I spoke with a professor who is very well informed about the language of thought theory against which I was trying to argue. And he read through my argument and basically told me where all the weaknesses in my argument were, and I panicked and was like, oh no, I have to trash the whole thing. Why did I even write this paper and spend all this time on it? But then after calming down and thinking about it and speaking with him more, it actually ended up enriching the paper because I was able to identify and defend the parts of the paper that were weaker and even write an entirely different section of the paper where I could better defend that part of my thesis. So that kind of taught me to don't panic and don't trash it, even if things go wrong.
From my research, a major like pivot point for me was that I knew that I was incorporating like African culture into our artistic medium. And so because of the things that we've seen that happened in Hollywood, which we know haven't been great in terms of appropriation, I knew I didn't want that to happen, especially being a person of color. So in order to ensure that my advisor and I teamed up with a professor in the history department, named Professor Talib, who specializes in African history and actually uses the movie Black Panther in his syllabus. And so he read all my research, and then he gave me a list of notes that was like this long. And I was like, wow. And basically what we did was I made a fictional country in Africa, and the goal was to incorporate a multitude of different African cultures into one place so that you get a wide range of experiences like in one show. He informed me that that was a problematic thing that had been done throughout history, and he advised me to narrow it down to just two cultures. So we use what we call the Lion King design concept, which is where they took Swahili and I think like Kenya, I believe, if I'm getting that right. So I took the Mali Empire and the Ghana Empire because they're in West Africa. And as an African American, that's where I have the most like connection to. And that's where I wanted my audience to have the most connection to. So that really helped my research go like a long ways because it narrowed my focus and it made me not want to like jump all around the place, but also like ethically, it gave me like a means to do so. And I just wrapped up all of my designs for it, and I teamed up with an architect student who was like designing some of the stage stuff. So like, my thing was really like reaching across to networking across campus.
I'll also say with my research, much of it started as I was looking at Catholicism as a universal thing and thinking that it could be applied to the United States and what I was looking at, like specifically with US law. And I realized that the United States had developed this entire Catholicism that was like very independent of something at the Vatican. And so I went from looking at like how the church was influencing it as to how Americans were using Catholicism to further their like political needs. And so then I started to realize that a lot of why the US has capital punishment is based in our like, race relations and our racial issues here. And so my project largely, within the past like 3 months, has largely become a part of race and like how all of that is kind of playing into our justice system. And I think for me, if I was doing this alone, it would be very scary because I am a white woman in a predominantly white school, and so I don't really have the confidence to go about and talk about race relations on my own. And I think having this group, the Keck Fellows, to sort of bounce my ideas off of and see how they're doing it has given me the confidence to be able to go out into the public. And I started reaching out to other schools about having the exhibit go there, and I have a lot more confidence going and speaking about what I've researched and not worrying about bringing up not only capital punishment, but also now lynching. And also just having the support of people like Jesse Mills, who I'm in his class, and having that support from the Ethnic Studies Department and being able to get media material. And conversations even within his class have really helped guide my research and given me that confidence to speak about it. So yes.
Initially, I thought that my project was going to be really straightforward because I'm well, I read these plays, I think they're the best thing ever, and I always really want to learn about the science they present. And so then I worked as dramaturge for production of my favorite one of the science plays that deals with science, and the audience was more ambivalent. Some of them thought it was brilliant, some of them just said, look, I didn't understand any of this. So I was like, okay, I'm going to have to go a lot more in depth. I'd originally planned on doing this grand historical survey of how, starting with Brecht's Life of Galileo in the 1940s, how did 1940s audiences react compared to how did current ones react? What stuck out to them? And I was like, okay, I'm gonna have to go down and just figure out what aspects of the play make the audience interested in and engaged in and understand the science, and what kind of shuts them off. So instead of having so many plays to deal with, I've had to narrow my focus to just 5 contemporary ones, because my favorite ones were all contemporary, and there's a lot more reviews to draw on. And so I've just been going in a lot more on these specific techniques and what makes them work and what doesn't. And it varies from production to production even, because different directors can pull out different things. And I guess I conceive this as a much more broad sweeping thing instead of going really specifically into a few. So that definitely changed a lot.
Something I would add, and I feel like a lot of people have either directly or indirectly mentioned this, is talking about your research with other people. So I've made an effort to go to research conferences and present my research, and that has helped a lot with the involvement of my research in regards to, I'll see how people react to what I'm saying, what connects, what doesn't, what is clear, what I need to maybe focus more on in the future. And because a lot of times when ideas are just in your head, it makes a lot of sense to you. And then you say it out loud and you realize that you need to work on it more. So I would, whatever research you do pursue, and just with your papers in general, I think in class, talking about it with someone else, getting the ideas out there, because research, in my opinion, shouldn't be something in the ivory tower closed off just to you in the library. It should be something like a source of knowledge that you're sharing with everyone else. You're contributing to the community. And that's been important for me, and I believe for everyone else. So that's what I would suggest, that if you do any kind of research, make sure you're sharing it.
So I think that my feeling about the evolution of my research, at least right now, is less so that my research has evolved, more so my perception of my research. Because when I had started this project, I really thought that it was going to be pretty linear. I thought that I was just going to go from A to B to C, and it's so not that. It's a large part of my project is concerned with preparing the text that I want to attribute authors to for statistical analysis, which requires that the spelling of words is standardized throughout the text. And the issue is so not trivial, because you're kind of casting a net with these computer programs to catch words that are the same, or at least mean the same thing, but are the spellings being varied throughout the text. And what tends to happen is you catch words that you don't want to, or you don't catch all the words that you need to. And it's this constant game of overshooting and undershooting, or it just doesn't work at all. And it's this iterative process of making something happen and then undoing it and then making it happen again in the way that you want. And I think that that's something that I've also had to overcome, that I had to realize that it's not supposed to be so, I don't know, it's not supposed to have such a straight flow. It's kind of this big, circular problem.
Okay, I think we've got about 10 more minutes on what we planned, and I'd like to just see if there's a question or two. You have a great opportunity to check with our fellows here.
So hi, my name is Tracy, and I work in the office-sponsored program, so we work with the faculty researchers and some of the student researchers in our office. So thank you for sharing. I think your projects were all really, really neat. What I'm interested in is, now that you have, a few of you talked about that your scope was very wide and you brought it in more narrow, would any of you consider applying for external funding, say, now that you have this, got your feet wet here with the Keck Fellows, would you consider applying for something more external? I'm not suggesting necessarily the federal government, but maybe something from a foundation. Do you feel that you have enough of a foundation to write a project, or would that maybe be a goal for a next step with your research to continue?
Oh, please go ahead. Well, I've found for my project that I know what I want to, like, if I do end up going to grad school and, like, sort of dramaturgy and theater research, I know what project I want to follow, is because I've noticed, looking at mine, that even more narrow than the lens I'm currently working on is the way that these plays talk about the relationship between intellectual passion and physical passion, especially in related to women scientists. And I feel like that could be a massive project that I would really want to pursue beyond this program, beyond college, and I never would have known that that was a thing these plays were doing if I hadn't done this.
I know my experience with the Keck, it's been exciting in the sense that I've talked to my mentor, and we know, like, the Keck deadline is coming to a close and all, but I want to use this for grad school next year and all for applications, so we know this is going to be, like, a much longer project. And it's funny, doing this project, it's almost hard reading all these things and finding, like, all these things, because there's so much that you can, like, go, well, I feel like just this, like, narrow topic could be, like, my life project of a work, you know, like, I get a dissertation and just focus on this, and it might never end. So in that regard, like, yes, and I think the Keck was, it was amazing to be able to find that, like, to be able to find a passion, and then find a passion that can take you forever on the path. So, and it's funny you mentioned that. I didn't even know that was something that was possible.
Me too.
Yeah,
I do that.
I love that. I had no idea you could even get extra.
This was getting your feet wet.
Yeah.
I think for myself, mine has started sort of kind of moving out of an educational realm and more into, like, social justice political realm. And so with the exhibit that I designed, I was a part of another fellowship that kind of, connected me with museum curators in the local San Diego area, and I was just reached out to by the Innocence Project about who works with people who are on death row, who shouldn't be on death row, basically, and they reached out about taking the exhibit from me and sort of bringing it around the nation, especially as the next election cycle is coming up. And so I think that is something that I'd be interested in getting funding with, is, like, developing my ideas into a more tangible product so that it can have a greater impact on the next election. And so I think that's more of, like, the funding is kind of away from the research and more of the presentation sense.
For me, I'm trying to get it produced, so yes, I'll take all the money.
Well, we just did a class last week for the MFA students, the graduate students, on how to get funding for their project.
Yes.
So there is funding out there, so for all of you. I was just hoping all of you, the answer was yes.
Another question?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Jennifer Wixie. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Psychological Sciences, and I also work in the Provost's office. And I don't have a question, but it's more of a comment, and that is, I was really pleased to see how all of you spoke about your experience with the fact, I'll use your word, that the project wasn't really long. It wasn't as linear as you expected it to be. And I think that's just how it works, right? I think so many of us in here have had that experience, myself included, that you have the idea, and you come up with these hypotheses, or you come up with this project plan, and it doesn't always work out the way that you want. And sometimes it can be so frustrating, and you just say, you know, I'm not going to continue this, or how am I going to get funding for this? You know, how am I going to continue, you know, on with these ideas? But I also hear so many of you speaking about passion. When we were talking, you totally lit up, and all of you did, you're talking about your passions, and I thought that's exactly what they need to keep going. So if you ever feel like, oh, you know, I'm hitting a barrier, and it's not going exactly the way that I thought, just know that every single one of us in here has experienced that, and yet we're still here, and you're not alone, and I just want to encourage you to keep doing what you're doing, because to find something that you love, you don't always find it, and the fact that you all found it, and you're speaking so eloquently and thoughtfully, so I just want to thank you all for the work that you've done to keep you motivated.
Thank you.
Well, let's go ahead and we'll just go one more time down the road, and maybe just a final thought, or if you have any advice, or just any parting thought you would have for our guests. And just also for your information, we'll follow the panel with the fellows with information. So if you'd like information about the application cycle or how to approach the next year of fellowships, you can just hang tight and we'll get to that. But Emma, can you start us out and we'll go down the road with you?
Sure. I would say that what I learned most about this is that if you pick something that you really care about, that even though it gets really frustrating sometimes, and even though writing it out is really hard and like laborious work, it will still be like fun and exciting if it's a topic that you care about and could talk about for hours if anyone would let you.
Time to give a final thought. I'm kind of put on the spot here, and I'm feeling the pressure. I'm drawing a complete blank, but I'll use that as my final thought. If you're having trouble coming up with an idea, or you feel a lot of pressure, just let it pass, and everything will still be okay.
Mine's kind of about like more so the material benefits of the Keck, because I know we've all experienced like the passion and the intellectual benefits, but I like highly suggest the Keck because it not only allows you to do this, but it funds you in a way where your research is funded, and you also get a stipend. And coming from like a low income like household and like experience homelessness like while at the school, this like allowed me to like quit my job and like focus solely on schoolwork and stuff. And so I think it's not just like the intellectual benefits that come along with it, but it allows people to be able to like invest in that intellectual, you know, endeavor without the material costs that weigh on you. So I thought that was really, really cool about the Keck.
And I suppose I'll speak to the intellectual aspect. I'd say don't be afraid to go out of your comfort zone and what you're already studying. I'm an international business major,
so that has not a lot to do with what I'm looking at.
And so I think being comfortable just like with your, like, I don't want to say shortfalls or weaknesses, but like I don't particularly pride myself on being a writer or like a fast reader even. And so I put myself in a position of something that I was totally foreign to. And I think this is a really great opportunity to like have enough support that you are able to sort of redirect what your focus is in college and like explore multiple things. So I'm really happy I did something totally outside of my business comfort zone.
Yeah, I would definitely just say for anyone that's considering applying to the Keck Fellowship, you probably should. There's no reason not to. And I think that the benefits of it have so far outweighed any pain that it's caused. my other thought is that it's been so wonderful. Even though I don't necessarily like spend a ton of time in the United States here, it's been really nice to get to know the community that's available. I spend all my time downstairs, like in the basement of the math and CS department, and it's a lot nicer up here. bigger windows and more toys. People with like, you know, the social is a little different.
My final thoughts would be that, you know, sometimes we think of like research as like having to do with something like a part of the sciences. Mm-hmm. I know, especially for me, I didn't consider what I was thinking of as research, and I would say that anything worth researching is something that you're passionate about. So all the things that you stay home late at night up, like Googling on your computer, or like looking up on Pinterest, or even Instagram, like all those things are worth researching. So like, to give an idea around that, and then you can put your research into that. And as long as you just keep pursuing something that you're passionate about, you'll always be happy. So, yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.